Hi, I am Dr. Felice Gersh, your integrative OBGYN physician, speaking to you from Irvine, California. I'm here in my office doing my Instagram Live, and I welcome you to my special show on fasting for women. For those of you who haven't met me, I'd like to do a brief introduction. I practice integrative medicine. I'm board certified in both OBGYN and integrative medicine. That means that I look for the most efficacious and natural ways for the body to heal itself, but when necessary, I will use pharmaceuticals and, of course, surgery, but only when I need to. So one of the most amazing tools that we can access to enhance our overall health is fasting. So that's what we're talking about in my Instagram show. All different aspects of fasting. Today, I want to talk to you about one specific type of intermittent fasting called time-restricted eating, sometimes spoken of as time-restricted feeding. So just to know, to help you know the difference between those two terms, when they say time-restricted feeding, they're usually referring to animal studies because they feed the animals. When you say time-restricted eating, you're referring to humans. So that sometimes will help you when you look at articles, when you're looking for research. Talking about research, I can tell you that it's only recently that we've had significant research on humans involving time-restricted eating. But let me tell you what time-restricted eating is first. Well, first of all, fasting, the very notion of fasting, is actually uncomfortable for a lot of people because eating is one of the most enjoyable things that we do. But it turns out that our human bodies are not designed to constantly eat, not for optimal health, not even at all. So we must pause in our eating periodically in order to allow our bodies to regenerate. It turns out that everything in the body has sort of a push-pull, hot-cold. The Chinese had it right so many thousands of years ago with the yin-yang. There's always a balance, and that's what is the whole notion of fasting. We must balance eating with not eating. So any time that you're not eating, you are fasting. So there's many different types of fasting or not eating. As you may know, many religious affiliations are associated with different types of fasting. There are fasting holidays, there's fasting in so many different cultures. So that's not by accident. I think ancient peoples learned that fasting is part of human life in terms of the way that humans evolved. Well, it turns out that the 24-hour day, that's based on the circadian rhythm. Our Earth has a 24-hour rotation on its axis. And our genes and our bodies are programmed according to that 24-hour rotation. It's amazing how earthling we are. We are not from another planet. We are totally evolved for planet Earth. So in order for survival, our bodies evolved over time based on who would be most likely to survive to have a certain way of eating that's optimal for our bodies. It turns out that we are most attuned to eating most efficiently when we eat most of our food in the morning hours. So what does that mean? It means that the insulin that our bodies produce from our pancreas works better. Our cells are most aligned for eating. So when you eat in the morning, the tissue actually absorbs the glucose from the cells more. The glucose is absorbed from the blood into the tissues, into the cells, much more readily. So what does that encounter in terms of the environment in the cell? Well, the cells need glucose. That's the primary energy source. So the cells are going to work so much better when they get glucose, their energy source, in the morning. In order for that to happen, you need to have the proper function of the glucose transporter system. That involves a whole array of signaling agents and so forth. It turns out that they're programmed according to our genetics to work better in the morning. It takes less insulin to get glucose from the blood into the cells, into the tissues in the morning than later at night. Now, why does that matter? Well, it turns out that having high levels of glucose in the blood for prolonged periods of time is very pro-inflammatory. We do not want to have our bodies in a pro-inflammatory state. We want to get the glucose that comes from our GI tracts when we eat transported rapidly into the cells. So when we have insulin sensitivity, it's much more efficient in terms of how that process works. It takes less insulin for that to happen. Now, what happens when we eat later in the day? We are more insulin resistant. That means the insulin doesn't work as well, the glucose levels in the blood will rise, and it will take a higher amount of insulin to accomplish the same goal of getting the glucose from the blood into the cells. So then you end up having higher and more prolonged amounts of insulin. So when you have higher amounts of insulin, you are now also getting into a state where you have insulin resistance that leads you down the path to prediabetes and diabetes, which is associated with a host of metabolic dysfunctions. So here's what the research is showing. It turns out that when humans eat the bulk of their food in the morning and eat none at night, their bodies work in terms of their metabolic function enormously better. The studies are not even equivocal. They're very clear. When people eat the vast majority of their food in the morning and stop eating, and they don't eat into the night hours, every aspect of their metabolic function is improved. There was a recent study that was published in the last couple of years that did an 8-hour window of eating. And we'll talk about how you can modify this, because this is very difficult. And I'll tell you about another study on women with PCOS that is very comparable in its findings and outcome. So in this recent study, they took people and they gave them almost all their food for breakfast. And then they gave them a lunch and they had to finish eating completely, forks down, by 3 p.m. Not one bite was to be consumed. Not a single calorie would enter the body after 3 p.m. Now, what they did in this study, they wanted to make sure this wasn't about weight loss, because many people say, well, you're just going to eat less food when you eat over a shorter period of time in the day. And that often is true. And that's why doing what I'm telling you, time-restricted eating, is one of the best ways for people who need to lose weight to lose weight, because not only does their whole metabolism shift for the better, but they also will often consume fewer calories during the day if they were already consuming excessive amounts of calories. But in this study, what they did was they made sure no one lost weight. So it would not be a study about weight loss. It was strictly a study about time-restricted eating. So in this study, where they ate most of their food for breakfast and then some for a late lunch, and not one bite and not one drink of anything with calories thereafter, they found that every metabolic parameter improved. They made the study subjects consume enough food so that not one lost any weight at all. So this was not about weight loss. There was no weight loss in this study. And yet every parameter. So what are we talking about? Their insulin sensitivity improved. Blood pressure improved. Inflammation markers improved. Sleep quality improved. Their joints felt better. You know, everything in the body worked better. It's amazing how this improved all of these different functions in the body, because inflammation went down, insulin sensitivity improved. This is so important as a take-home message, that we can change, even without losing weight, we can dramatically improve our health just by shifting the time of day that we eat during the 24-hour day. In future talks, we're going to get into other forms of intermittent fasting, but this one is where you start. I never start with multi-day fast. I always start with time-restricted eating. I wanted to mention this Israeli study that came out also a few years ago, which was really mind-boggling in terms of its success. There are no pharmaceuticals that come even close to what this accomplished for the patients in the study. They took women with polycystic ovary syndrome. That's the most common endocrine disorder of women and associated with every kind of metabolic dysfunction and infertility and pregnancy complications. Lots and lots of prediabetes, insulin resistance, and endothelial dysfunction, that's vascular dysfunction. So in the study, they had the women eat about 2/3 of their calories for the day for breakfast and about 1/3 for lunch. And then actually they left over just a few bites for an early dinner, just a very few bites. What they found in no length of time at all, like even in a month, that their insulin levels fell by about 50%. That's phenomenal. For those of you who are interested in losing weight, one of the problems is that when you have high glucose or even elevated glucose, doesn't have to be dramatically high, but it's elevated throughout the entire day, you're going to keep producing insulin to try to control the blood sugar, because blood sugar should not be running around at high levels. Blood sugar should be at a nice level, healthy level. So we're talking about in the 70s or in the 80s. It should not be in the hundreds. So your body will produce insulin to try to transport the blood sugar into the cells where it belongs so that you can create energy and do the jobs of the cells that need to be done. So what happens when you eat all day long is you have chronically high blood sugar and chronically high insulin. So in this group of women with PCOS, and women with PCOS often have very significant insulin resistance, so they have high levels of insulin and they tend to have higher levels of blood sugar, which create inflammation throughout their bodies and leads to a whole array of metabolic dysfunction. So in taking these women who have these underlying problems, and they gave them about 2/3 of their calories for breakfast, 1/3 for lunch, and just a little bitty bit for dinner, as I mentioned, their insulin levels plummeted by 50%. For those of you who didn't know, when you have chronically high insulin, it promotes fat production and fat storage. You cannot lose weight if your insulin level stays high. It's absolutely impossible. You can't, it's like multitasking. You cannot make fat and burn fat simultaneously. So in this study, their insulin level went down. That's the first step in enabling someone to actually lose weight. What also happened in this study, it showed that their 17-hydroxyprogesterone fell by almost 40%. So what does that mean? Well, 17-hydroxyprogesterone is a precursor to cortisol. So we don't want to have high cortisol. High cortisol also creates insulin resistance and can also make you feel very stressed. So we don't want to feel stressed. That's why meditation works, but that's not part of this story. But I'll tell you, when you do time-restricted eating, you're going to feel more interested in so many things, like exercise, like meditation, because you're just going to feel so much better. What they also find when people do time-restricted eating is that the processes in the cell that are geared towards fatty acid metabolism, lipid oxidation, that means burning fat for energy, they're upregulated. So there's this signaling agent called a kinase. It's called AMP kinase. Some people call it a switch from producing fat to burning fat. And that is actually upregulated when you do time-restricted eating. Now, many people do what they call time-restricted eating, but they do it exactly backwards. And this is very prevalent on the internet. So I want to warn you, please don't do this. In fact, they've done studies that show that when you do this, which I'm just going to describe in a moment, you actually can either have no terrible effect, that is possible, or you may actually be much worse off. So what am I talking about? If you eat so that you fast, but you're fasting through most of the day, especially through those key morning hours when you're most receptive to food, and then you put most of your eating into the latter half of the afternoon and into the evening hours. So then you get a very prolonged fast, but you're actually doing it at the totally wrong time of day. I want to make that over. Do not do that. I know so many people are doing that now. They're doing the 16-8, but the 16-hour fast is through the most important hours of the day when you actually should be eating. What they found is that people who do that and they concentrate most of their food to the very end of the day, the late afternoon and into the evening, they often have worsening of their insulin resistance, worsening of their blood pressure, worsening of the health of their vascular system. You do not want to do that. And it can also downregulate that really important kinase, AMP kinase, that triggers fat burning. So the ticket to gaining weight, to have metabolic dysfunction, is to eat most of your calories at night. Now, if you also, in addition to eating most of your calories at night, you also don't even fast through the earlier part of the day, but you eat during the early part of the day. So you're eating something, maybe a little tiny breakfast, often maybe a bad breakfast, like maybe a roll or a bagel or a donut or something like that. And then you have maybe a traditional lunch, which is not good, like a burger and fries. And then you have this big meal for dinner, and then you start eating snacks all night long. That is the absolute pathway to metabolic dysfunction, diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, dementia, osteoporosis, you name it. Every bad medical condition you can think of is going to be promoted by that kind of a lifestyle choice. So eating that way is the worst thing you can do. Snacking during the day is also a problem because every time you eat, you will raise your blood sugar and you will then raise your insulin, and that is not what we want to do. Now, if you have to snack, and some people just have to snack, and I hope that will change, and I'll tell you why that can change, but try to snack on something that is fatty, like olives or avocados or macadamia nuts or pecans. Those are very high in fats, healthy fats, and I want you to eat those. I just prefer you not to eat them as snacks. I would prefer you eat them with your breakfast or maybe your lunch. But if you have to, at least that won't raise your insulin because it won't raise your blood sugar too much. So what else can you do? Well, what if you just say, you know, this is like much too hard. I mean, I'm willing to eat breakfast. At least, please give me that. Eat a very hearty breakfast. But what if you say, like, there's no way. My family wants to eat dinner. I socialize. I can't live that life. Well, let's look at a pragmatic solution. I always like to start with best, and then we'll work into better. There's an expression, never let best be the enemy of better. So if you can't do what I described, where you eat all your food for, you know, most of your food for breakfast, and then the rest of your food for a medium or maybe late kind of a lunch, but you have forks down by 3 p.m. What if you say you're not going to do that, at least not too often? Okay, so here's another option. You eat a big hearty breakfast. That is not negotiable, okay? You're not gonna talk me out of eating a big hearty breakfast. So you, whatever you have to do, whether you have to get up earlier, you can prepare most of the food the night before, you can eat a lot of leftovers, you eat a big hearty breakfast. And you know what I mean by that, right? It's really healthy food. Lots of vegetables, whole grains, nuts, seeds, kind of like a really healthy dinner for a breakfast. And I love what I call a breakfast salad. You have every kind of salad food. You can put in all the beautiful fruits of summer into that salad, nuts and seeds. And if you want to, you can put in beans or lentils or a little bit of animal protein. And you have this amazing, delicious breakfast salad. And that I have had so many of my patients who needed to lose weight, they start their day with this giant breakfast salad. And guess what? They're not so hungry. This is really an important message. Studies have shown that when people eat this big hearty breakfast, they have much less, fewer cravings, desire for snacks as the day progresses. You just have to bite the bullet and do this. And if you say, I'm just not hungry in the morning, that means you have circadian rhythm dysfunction. Just eat it anyway. You know, I'm sure that there are many people who start any kind of lifestyle change program, and initially they say, but I don't want to do it, I don't really like it, I don't enjoy it. You are a very smart person. Just do it anyway. You will adapt to it. It won't take too long, maybe 4 weeks, maybe 6 weeks. That's all. You just do it. Even if you're not hungry, you can do it. Just make it and eat it. And after a while, you will crave your breakfast, but you won't crave snacks. So, in fact, they showed studies that in the groups that had the big breakfast and then just the lunch, and they stopped eating at 3 o'clock, they did not crave eating later in the day and at night. I know that may seem impossible because you love to eat at night, but this was proven that when you do this, you change how your body works. You really change it so that you do not have those cravings. But okay, back to what if you won't do that because it just doesn't work with your lifestyle. Then do the following. Start off with a big, delicious, healthy breakfast, whether it's a breakfast salad or a breakfast stir fry, whatever, healthy foods, lots of vegetables, whole grains, beans, lentils, and such. Then you have a light lunch, a very, very light lunch. And then you have a medium early dinner and no snacks in between. That is not as good, but it's still really good. But what must you do? You must fast from dinner to breakfast for 13 hours. I know that's still hard. Try with 12 and try to work your way up to 13. So you can't eat a really late dinner if you're going to have 13 hours to breakfast. And remember, breakfast is not negotiable. So you can do breakfast within 2 hours of awakening. So if you need to extend the fast a little bit in the morning, you can. So if you get up at say 7, you could have breakfast at 9. Okay, but you should be finished by 9. Now that doesn't always work for people, but now many people at this time are working from home and they have more flexibility. So this is the most opportune time to get started on this program. If you have to, you have to adjust your schedule because this is what works for your body. You can say, I can change the color of my hair. You know, you can get different colored contact lenses and change the color of your eyes, but you are not going to be able to change your clock genes. We are genetically programmed in this manner. And when you do this, your metabolism is going to work better. You will achieve a healthy weight. You will over time, but even if your weight doesn't change, your metabolism will change. Your whole body will work better and your appetite will change. So I've never seen anyone do this and not actually lose weight. Who needs to lose weight? So I would say the chances are incredibly high that if you follow the time-restricted eating program that I'm describing, you will lose weight. If you can, over time, you can even go to having a big breakfast, skipping lunch altogether, and just hydrating, you know, having lots of teas, wonderful teas, and then having your early dinner, and then having your 13-hour fast. If you have to, as I said, if you have to snack during the day, for whatever reason, make it a fatty snack. Olives, avocado, macadamias, and pecans, but not a lot. It should be a very, very, when I say a little, I mean like 6 olives, 3 nuts, okay? A couple of bites of avocado, and then hydrate with some wonderful teas. There are so many wonderful herbal teas, and green tea actually improves your metabolism. It's antioxidant, it's fantastic. So, and if you don't like green tea, oolong tea, which I happen to love, because I'm not a big fan of the taste of green tea. I advocate for it, but I personally don't care as much for the taste as I do of oolong. Well, it turns out oolong, which I love, is a very close companion in terms of its antioxidant and anti-cancer and all of the other benefits that are ascribed to green tea are pretty much almost equal with oolong tea. So if you don't care for green tea, please try oolong tea. I bet you'll like it just as I do. So in summary, we are humans. We are designed over the thousands of years that we have been on planet Earth. We have evolved to be in alignment with our beautiful planet Earth and its 24-hour rotation on its axis. Our genes, our clock genes, are programmed for us to be most adept, most capable of eating our food and digesting it, which I didn't even get into. Let me just mention that quickly. Our digestive tract works best in the morning. For those of you who have acid reflux, GERD, if you follow what I'm telling you, it may completely resolve. And by the way, you will sleep better at night. I mean, pretty much everything in your life will be better if you do this. I've not seen any of my patients not improve dramatically when they do this. So you are most adapted as humans to eat in the morning and not eat at night. So please, a big breakfast and then a moderate lunch and stop eating for the rest of the day by 3. If that's just not gonna work for you, then have the big breakfast, a very small lunch, and then a medium dinner. You can reverse it. You can have the big breakfast, a medium lunch, and then a very tiny dinner. That's kind of like what they did with the PCOS women. But what you don't want to do is have like a smoothie that you keep sipping all day, or sugar-filled coffee that you keep sipping all day. If you eat sugar foods, you will keep your insulin up, your glucose up, and you will not be metabolically healthy. So I look forward to the next chapter in my Fasting for Women program. I hope you will join me. Fasting is trending for a good reason. The studies are really robust that fasting, not eating, is really important for human health. Thank you. Have a wonderful day. Stay safe.